Happy Easter, everybody.
I felt it first when I was younger. A strange connection to the light. I tried to satisfy the hunger. I never got it right.
Easter. The sun is up. That's the S-U-N and the S-O-N. The sun is risen. We're here to celebrate. We got a lot of things going on, and we're so happy to see so many people here. We had over 200 people over at the Beachside Sunrise Service. If you missed it, well, it's okay. I get it. Even my wife slept in this morning. Threw her under the bus. Boom. I like that. We have a birthday in the house. Pat Walsh's birthday. It's such a huge celebration because I think it's been about 3 years she's been in this battle with a lot of different health issues. So she's extremely happy to be rejoicing in another birthday. So if we could, let's say happy birthday for Pat. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Pat. Happy birthday to you. And we fully expect many more, because God is that good. For those of you who weren't privy to what's been going on here, if you knew, Gene Lofton has been coming here for years. I learned so many things about Gene over the last week or two. And we're going to do a special song in honor of Gene. We didn't get a chance to rehearse it as much as we like, so we're hoping for the best. But I'll announce that when the time comes. I'm just trying to put my head together. There's so many new faces here, and I don't like making a show of new people that show up at church. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands, but it's really nice to see so many faces out for Easter service. And I want to tell you that what we do here right now today for Easter is pretty much what we do every Sunday. You might feel like we're doing this special, like to hook you in and to make you think that we're something we're not, but I'm going to tell you, what you see here today is what we are, and that's what you get. It's called congruence. We are who we are, and we do what we do because we are who we are. And we're inviting you back. And if you feel comfortable here today and you feel like it's home, you might want to communicate with God and say, hey, God, is that my home church? And he might very likely tell you yes. That's up to you, between you and him. But we want to let you know you're invited. Did I say something to make you mad? We want to let you know you're always welcome back. We don't take attendance. We don't do membership. If you're a member of God's family, then you're a member of ours. And that's the way we feel about it, and that's the way it is. So this morning as we start, let's open up with a quick word of prayer. And I want to pray a prayer of thanks to the Father. Father, we thank you so much that you loved each and every one of us so much that you made a way for us to be made holy and righteous, that we would find a way to live in this world that is so horrible sometimes and walk in peace and to walk in love and to walk in joy, because we can do it through the leadership of the Spirit that you placed in us. God, we're so thankful for the gift of your Son and the gift of the Spirit that he placed in us, that we would be able to listen to your desires through your Spirit leading, and that we might be bold enough to step out in faith and say, Father, I trust you. Show me your way. And we can walk in that. Father, for all that you continue to do in our lives, we come today to celebrate the risen Christ. We come today to thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. So as we go forward, we're going to start out with our song by Mary. And she's I always call her a maniac, but I think she's from New Hampshire, so... No, she is the maniac. All right, so she's one of my sister maniacs. There's a couple of maniacs back there. If you want to holler, give her a hoot and holler from Maine. All right.
One day, a plain village woman, driven by love for her Lord, the scorn. And once it was broken and spilled out, the fragrance filled all the room. Like a prisoner released from his shackles, like a spirit set free from the tomb, broken and spilled out, just for love of you, my most precious treasure, lavished on thee. His love and his own perfect son, sent here to show me the love of the Father, just for love it was done. And though you were perfect and holy, you gave up yourself willingly. You spared no expense for my pardon. You were used up and wasted for me. Just for love of me, Jesus, God's most precious treasure, lavished on me.
Here today in celebration because he lives. Because he lives. Awesome news. Thanks, Mary. With
God sent his son.
They call him.
Housekeeping here. You know that we've been meeting here, this Memorial Day will be 10 years. And why I'm bringing that up is 10 years, for 10 years, Patty has had staff in place to set up when we show up on a Sunday morning when they're really not used to this many people showing up. Sometimes we have well over 400 every Sunday through season. And the girls are here early, way before us even. They're setting up the tables, they're wiping down, they're setting up napkins. And I think this would be a great day to bless the staff here. So there's an offering bucket right here behind the sound stage. We don't want to make a big show of it, but if you feel led to bless the staff for Easter, this might be a great way to show them a little bit of thanks for all that they do. Whether you've bought anything or not, they are here setting up the tables, putting the napkins out. They are dedicated. A lot of them, we've seen changes in all of their lives, including Patty, right from day one. We have seen drastic changes because God is good, and we have been invited into the family of the island. So if you would do that, this song here is a challenge for us. I'm just giving you a heads up, but I've been wanting to do this song for about 8 out of the 10 years we've been here, and we're going to give it a shot, so we could use some encouragement. And if you hear us go off key, applaud so you can't tell. I trust God, I don't trust my throat.
Not a word was heard at the tomb that day. Just shuffling soldiers' feet as they guarded the grave. One day, 2 days, 3 days had passed. Could it be that Jesus breathed his last? Could it be that his father had forsaken? in him, turned his back on his son, despising our sin. All hell seemed to whisper, just forget it, he's dead. Then his father looked down to his son and said, arise, my love, arise, my love. The grave no longer has a hold on you. No more death sting, no more suffering. Arise, arise, my love. The earth trembled, and the tomb began to shake. And like lightning from heaven, the stone was rolled away. And this dead man and the guards, they just stood there in fright, as the power of love displayed his might. The words all creation had been longing to hear, the sweet sound of victory so loud and clear. Arise, my love, arise, my love.
Was great.
Excellent job, girls. Woo! Are they hot today or what? Mark's got the sound angels on his side, I can tell. He calls them the sound angels. He said he can see the sound angels telling him which wires the sound is going through. He's kind of crazy that way, but it's okay if it works, and it seems to. That's our sound guy, but he's not a sound man. Love you, Mark. Thank you. Miss Wendy's going to take the kids out front, and they're going to have their own little Easter gathering. If you want to send the kids out, they're in good hands. They don't have to go, but they're welcome to go if they want. There'll probably be some goodies out there and a few people helping Wendy. Wendy, get a count of how many kids we have, because I want to send a note to God, let them know that they were here. We're glad to have all of you here. I met some people today, two different tables from Wisconsin. I'm still waiting for my cheesehead over there, Wisconsin. Hey, I'm talking to you. Look over here. Hey, can you hear me? Can you tap him, the guy in the yellow shirt? He's not even paying attention. Hello, is this on? I'm still waiting for my cheesehead. I got two other tables, said they're going to bring me some. I have a feeling I might have a whole box full of them one day. Just messing with you. I met people from Wisconsin. I met people from Minnesota today, people from Michigan. I don't know if we've ever had, we got people from Hawaii here. I ought to kind of maybe start up a little map up here, and if you're from somewhere, let us know, and we'll put the state in and see if we got somebody from all 50. What do you think? And we might have to get a globe, too, because I know we got people in Spain and Canada. So I get a little crazy if I'm off the east coast of the USA. I'm not sure if North Dakota is down below New Mexico or not, but it says north, so that's a probably good guess. Pastor Bob this morning is over at Ocean Village, and he's doing an Easter service over there. And things are really starting to change. If you're not with us on Facebook, look up Reach Thrift Store. If you want to see a hoot, there's a guy doing commercials for us for Reach Thrift Store, and he's crazy. He's crazy. So every week he's putting out a new commercial, and we're trying to get that scared up and get some business in. But the way I understand it, that first video went out, hit over 1,700 people in just a few days. So Facebook, obviously, is one of those good tools that we can use. The thrift store is located at 1401 North US 1, the corner of Avenue M and US 1. If you have stuff to donate, call, drop it off Tuesday through Saturday. That's another mission that we're working on, and we've got so many teams in place. Rick and Patty are our video team. That's how we get the video out on the internet. It's been out there, I guess we're going on 4 years, 4.5 years of video is out there for you to watch. Share us with your friends. It sounds like a huge marketing thing, but I do this every Sunday. this whole ministry here is amazing to me because I sat with some friends the other night who invited my wife and I out to dinner, and they started hearing some of my backstory, and it's like, uh-oh. When I got home, I thought, maybe I shouldn't have told them so much. But they showed up here this week anyway, so I guess they see a change that God has made, but there's some pretty scary things that went on in my life, and I was hesitant to go back to Maine for a few years, afraid that there might be a couple of warrants out for me. It's crazy. But God made some great changes in me, and the great changes that he's made in me, the biggest one, I think, is this, is that I get to be free to be myself. I've found that I am okay with me because God is okay with me. And wherever I am right now, even when I have doubts, even when I make mistakes, I can run back to God's love and say, Dad, do you still love me? And he says yes, every single time. He just accepts me for who I am, but he wants me and he grows me to be better than I am every day through the leadership of his Spirit. So the gift that we have is the gift of the Spirit that he places within us. And we're going to talk about that today in this study. This Easter study is about the rejoicing. It talks about the day that Mary Magdalene and another Mary went into the where the tomb was, that Jesus was laid to rest after his crucifixion. And they went to just go to visit Christ's tomb, and they found that it was empty. The stone had been rolled away. And they looked inside, and Jesus' body was nowhere to be found. And the angels announced that Jesus was alive. The angels let him know that he was alive. The other part of the weird study, and I'm not going to tell you I know why it says everything it says in the Bible. I won't be that guy. I don't know. But I did read a section in the Bible that when Jesus died on the cross and it got dark, that bodies of believers rose from the grave and walked the earth. Dead people walk the earth. It's written in the scriptures, and I'm going, what's that all about? And I can't tell you I have the answer, but when Mary Magdalene and Mary were in the garden and they saw this body walking around, they weren't sure it was Jesus. It wasn't like he's the only one. You see what I'm saying? And when the angel announced Jesus is alive and he called to them, he said, it's me. And they went, it's you. You did raise. You did rise from the grave. And he told her to go and tell the disciples the good news. Well, the good news is, and we want to back this up through all the studies that we've done in the chapters of Luke and all the studies that we've done reading up to Easter, the good news is that Jesus was, in fact, the Messiah, the promised King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the promised King of the Jews. He was, in fact, the Son of God, and he proved it by rising from the grave. Not only that, but every single prophecy that was spoken about him, that he would ride into town on a donkey, he would be born in a humble setting, that he would be a person that people didn't understand because of his love and his message. We talked about last week the difference between the religious folks, who were the Pharisees and Sadducees, and the religious leaders, and Jesus. See, the religious leaders, they had the law written for them. They asked for it, and they said, tell us how you want us to live. And here came the Ten Commandments. And they said, okay, you're not supposed to kill, and you're not supposed to steal, and you're not supposed to do this, and you're not supposed to do that, and you can't do that, and you have to do this, and you shouldn't do that, and you can't do that. And that wasn't enough for them. As religious leaders, they took each letter of the law and created another law to live by, because the more laws we have, the safer it gets, right? Do you know that in the United States, we're the nation with the most laws in place, but we're also the nation with the most people in prison? We're the nation with the most homicides? We're the nation with the most problems? And we have more laws than any other nation. So are laws working? No. The law was never meant to change an individual. The law was laid down. Here's why it says in the Bible, I'm going to give you my translation, but in the Bible it says it this way, that every man's tongue would be stilled and all would be found guilty before God. In modern day language, I see it this way. It's God's way of saying, shut up and pay attention. You can't do this on your own. You failed. Okay? And it doesn't mean you're a failure. It means you can't possibly do it. And I have seen many, many homes with the posters on the wall and with the writing on their front door and with the little bumper sticker on their car that says, as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord, right? And that sounds really good, doesn't it? But if you read two or three verses after that, and that's a great intention, by the way, as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. Like, it's not going to not happen. See, shall is a pretty strong legal word, isn't it? When you go into court, if the judge says, you shall do this, you shall do it, or you shall go to jail. Shall is more than a you might. It needs to happen. It has to happen. It's a command. As for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. And that sounds really good. But the reality of it is written about a few verses afterwards, and it says you're not going to be able to do it alone. The very person who spoke that word spoke to the crowds. And this was after they crossed through the parting of the Red Sea. And they were so rejoicing that after 40 years in the desert, they were set free and they came into the land of milk and honey. By the way, it wasn't them, it was their children. The people who went into the desert didn't come out. But their children did. And they said, we finally made it after 40 years of getting across that three-week journey. And now we get it. Now we're really going to trust God. As for me and my house, you watch and see how I'm going to perform. The Pharisees and the Sadducees took the laws and they told people how to live. And Jesus was really kind of ticked off at them, if you read it in the book of Matthew. He called them several times hypocrites. Now, I've heard a whole lot of people say we're not going to go to church because of the hypocrites. I ain't go to church. They're a bunch of hypocrites. They say one thing and do another. These are the same words Jesus used for the Pharisees. You'll tell people how to live, but you won't live that way yourself. You'll put heavy burdens on people's backs, and then you won't help them to accomplish their goals. You're a pack of vipers. Here's one that they call them, sons of hell. But wait a minute, these are religious leaders. The religious leaders put the law down. When you didn't follow the law, they built a case against you. Sounds a lot like the legal system now. Get three witnesses, and then we'll condemn you to death. We'll stone you. So the religious leaders, by way of the law, would judge, they would convict, they would condemn, and they would kill. And Jesus shows up and says, that ain't the way God wants it. And they freaked out. Well, we're in control. And Jesus' words were, yeah, that's the problem. You're in control. And that's the problem. My Father wants to bring life, not death. My Father wants you to live free, not in bondage. My Father wants you to understand love, not judgment. My Father wants to change your heart, not make you perform better. Go tell that good news to your friends. See, the good news, the gospel has gotten confused over the years when you go into church and they say, you better change or you're going to hell. That does not sound like good news. You better straighten up and fly right or God's going to punish you. That don't sound like good news either. You better not say those words. or God might strike you deaf. See, we've gotten this idea that God is a punishing, vengeful God, when God is a blessing, loving, merciful, gracious, accepting God who wants you to live in freedom, not in bondage. And there's several kinds of bondage in this world, including religious bondage. You better do this or else. If you're being steered into something by man and told that it's God's work, and you don't have great joy in your heart, you might want to investigate what you're doing and why. Look into it. It came up this morning on my way in. I was praying because this message came in. Let's go on a little further. As they were on their way to go tell the disciples the good news, Jesus appeared to the women and instructed them, go tell the disciples to meet him in Galilee. Tell them, not just the good news that I'm alive, but meet me in Galilee. I'm going to be there. Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Well, why would Jesus have to tell them don't be afraid? Remember, they're walking dead. You know, and I look at the zombie movies that are so popular today, The Walking Dead. Where do they get this crazy idea? Don't be afraid. I am with you. Don't be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me. I had this brief conversation this morning because, and it was, I'm not making fun of you if you're still there. That's not the point. But she came up when we were on the beach, and she says, I need to ask a question. Explain the Messiah to me. In 2 minutes? You're asking a big, big chore. In a few minutes to explain the Messiah, that's the whole Bible is explaining it. But she wanted some clarity, and that's okay, and we look for that. The Messiah, the chosen one that was coming to save the people of Israel, that the people of Israel who knew their scriptures, who knew, memorized the first 5 books of the scriptures before they were 10 or 11 years old, who saw the prophecies in the rest of the scriptures that the Messiah will one day come and set his people free. The Messiah will come and change history. The Messiah will come and we shall be set free. And when they finally discovered that Jesus was the one, they realized, wow, we persecuted him. We ripped the hairs out of his beard. We shoved a crown of thorns down on his head. We poked him in the side, and that also fulfilled the scripture, and we didn't even realize it. And the whole time, he was giving himself over. We didn't take his life. He gave it. And he spread his arms to the people who were so hateful and making fun of him and said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They don't understand. My translation today, I know every single one of us knows somebody who comes at you with hate and vengeance, at least one person in your life. Could it be that they don't know God's love? Could it be that's why they're so miserable? Could it be they're trying to survive in this world by their own strength and they're so frustrated because they can't do it? And they don't know how else to protect their little wounded self inside but to put on a great offense as a defense. Imagine having a heart of compassion, seeing beyond the hardened shell of hatred, anger, resentment, and being able to see the wounds like Jesus did and call out to Dad and say, Dad, soften their heart. Dad, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They don't realize that they're in survival mode. Do you ever have a wild animal backed into a corner? Or just a little lizard? One of those little lizards. We have those lizards down here. You ever back one into a corner and really just kind of try and get them without actually getting them? They will back up and they'll get their mouth open and they'll look like a dragon. Their necks will throw red and they'll... And they'll bark at you because all they're trying to do is survive. And when somebody's in survival mode, they can easily become a dragon. But imagine what that being might be like if they started to experience the pouring out of God's love into their heart and realize that they don't have to be their own savior, that they can have a Savior that does it for them, and they can rest assured that it's covered. Hey, he's going to get in the offering bucket. Who trained that bird? Here's what Jesus told them when he finally met them. He told them that the Father had given him all authority over heaven and earth. My Father has given me all authority. You know what that's reminiscent of for me? The Garden of Eden. God said he took the elements of the earth and he formed man in their image, Father, Son, Spirit. He formed man in their image. And the first gift that he gave to us, do you know what it was? It was dominion over all living things. He gave man dominion over all living things. And here is Jesus saying, I have been given authority over all of heaven and earth. Come on. He's pretty active. There must be some French fries left over. But here's the important part. And I get on a soapbox sometimes because I'm frustrated too with what goes on in churches. I am. If I get honest, I'm very frustrated with what goes on in religion. And I don't like the word religion. I more prefer being in a relationship with my Father who loves me and allowing him to show his love through me. But what happens is, see, Jesus charged his disciples with this most important mission. And the mission is to take the good news into the world. Take the good news into the world, and we've turned it into a legalistic performance trap. And a lot of times in the church, the good news is you need to keep coming back here every week and fill in that bucket if you want to be blessed. Have you heard that message? That's kind of cutting to the chase, but that's what goes on. I mentioned it this morning. See, when you give freely because you know you don't have to worry about what you have, that's called freedom. When you give trying to get, that's called manipulation. When you give freely, you won't run out of stuff. When you give trying to get, you're going to find yourself frustrated that you're not getting what you think you deserve. Is it anybody else in the crowd that will hold the door for somebody on the way into Walmart, and if they don't say thank you, you'll get ticked off? You're welcome. I held the door for you. You didn't get your gimmies. See, you really have. Has anybody ever left a relationship with these words on their lips? After all I did for you. Yeah, I see a bunch of heads bobbing up and down. You look like bobbleheads. Yep, it happens. How about maybe you heard it from somebody else? After all I did for you. Okay? Listen to the rest of that statement. This is how you repay me. See, when somebody says those words, they leave off the second half because that reveals that the actual action was, I'm doing this for me, not for you. I'm going to make it look like I'm doing it for you, but when I don't get what I think I deserve for doing it for you, I'm going to get ticked. And for me, not only did I get agitated, I got angry, I got furious, and I even got violent in my past. Because I didn't get what I thought I deserved for all I did for you. And I would keep score sheets and dollar values and wonder why I was miserable. You know, I came here and I lived with you for 3 years and I bought you this and I fixed that and I painted this and I did that and you owe me $5,327.37. You blank. And I was weighted down with that whole mess. And you know what happens now since God has touched my heart? It took a few years, but I actually let some of that stuff go and got set free again. I actually brought one of those checklists back to somebody and said, here. And they said, oh, I know what that is. I know I owe you money and I'm going to pay you back. No. That's not why I'm bringing this to you. This thing has eaten my lunch for the last time. Take it away. We're done. I'm setting you free and I'm setting me free. I'm not doing this anymore. I started learning how to just give only when God was telling me to give. And then that raised the question, well, how do I know it's God? Well, God built in this system. God is really cool. When you get to down to reality in brass tacks, God built this system in us called our emotions. Okay? And if you're doing something thinking you're helpful, and you end up frustrated, agitated, confused, angry, I'm going to tell you that's probably you're not doing it for God. You might think you're doing it for God, but if you're actually doing it for God, the result will be joy. So there's a little litmus test that goes on with your emotions, okay? And how do I know that? Why? What do I base that on? John chapter 15, verses 10 and 11 say this way. Words of Jesus, if you follow my commandments, don't confuse it with the Ten Commandments, okay? If you follow the leadership of my spirit, if you follow my commandments, like I did my Father's commandments, I will abide in you and you will abide in me. If you're listening to the leadership of my spirit, I will be living with you and you'll be living with me and you'll find great joy in life. Not only will you find joy, here's what it says afterward. I tell you this so that my joy will remain in you and your joy might be full. So what do you think the result of following the leadership of the spirit will be? Three-letter word, begins with J, ends with Y, and got an O in the middle. Joy. It's a litmus test. If you're doing something thinking you're serving God and you're ticked off, check yourself and figure out why. Maybe you're looking for this. Maybe you're looking for a title on your door. Maybe you're looking for someone to donate to you. But if it's not joy, you're not getting the pay you deserve. Oh, wait a minute. Maybe you are getting the pay you deserve. Maybe you're just working for the wrong person. I have found out when I give and give freely, it gives great joy. What do you think we got? 300, 400 people here on the deck? Here's how giving works. I got enough food over there in the warehouse for 10,000 people. Come, eat all you want. Giving freely. I'm not going to run out. Go tell your friends. See, when we find the joy that comes with a genuine relationship with God, it's like a beggar who found a mountain of bread. And you'll want to go tell your friends. You'll want to share the good news. Not only will you want to, you don't have to, you get to. You get to help other people find the good news. You get to share the reality that's been being missed by religious people teaching you how you're supposed to perform to get God to love you. When the fact is, God already loves you. You just don't know it yet. The fact is, God forgave you 2,000 years ago. You just haven't accepted it yet. The truth is, God has a spirit he wants to lay inside of you to lead you into righteousness, and you haven't trusted it yet. Perhaps. Perhaps you have. Perhaps you trusted it, and then you went back to performing. And you're frustrated again. It's okay. God knows what it's going to take to grow you through that. He knows your pains. He knows your hurts. He knows what you're trying to do. And the trying isn't working. When you get a hold of that, stop trying and go back to trusting the spirit he put in you. What do you want, God? I have to hear this a lot from God. I want you to relax. Good. Well, I thought it was about all the things I'm doing for you. It's not. It's about what I've done for you. Relax. When I tell you go, go. And you'll find joy. And you'll find rest. And you'll find peace. And you'll find mercy and grace and compassion and love and forgiveness for others. They're called fruits of the Spirit. They're his fruit. Let him grow them. You can't possibly squirt out fruit on your own. You can't do it. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. Notice this, to observe what I've commanded. It doesn't say to do what I've commanded. Observe what I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I think it's teaching them to know that he is with you always. teaching you to know. Observe the commandments and understand they're there. But here's what I learned about the commandments. The first one says this, thou shalt have no other gods before me. And you know how I learned that? I was getting ready to be ordained, and they were bringing me up through the ranks, and I'm thinking, I'm not worthy of this. Why do you want to ordain me? I don't even know what the Ten Commandments are. And you want to make me a pastor? Well, we see your heart. You have a shepherd's heart. So we're bringing you up to lead. Wow. Well, I better go home and learn my Ten Commandments. I went right into performance mode. But here's how God handled it. I read the first one, and it said, thou shalt have no other gods before me. And that's the way I heard it in my head. And I went, you mean once I understand that God's God, I'll realize there are no other gods. And here's what happened next. The rest of those commandments, they're not rules and regulations anymore. They're promises. Once you know the first one, you shall not steal. Why would you? You shall not lie. Why would you? If the Spirit of God is leading you and God is your God, why would you lie? One of the reasons I lied in my past was to embellish my life so people might like me. I don't need that. I got God's love. One of the reasons I might lie is for fear of losing a friendship or a relationship. I don't need that. I got a relationship with God that's never going to fail. You're not going to steal either. Why? Because God's going to provide all your needs. You're not going to covet your neighbor's stuff. You're not going to cheat on your wife. Why? Because that's not God's love. And once you know that God's God and you let him deal with it, the rest are promises. Look at it for yourself and see if you can't make those a promise for your life. You get to keep them. You don't have to keep them. You're going to be able to do it because the leadership of God is going to show you how. His word written and spoken, he speaks into our soul through the Spirit and he writes his word, is a lamp unto your feet. If you want to take the next step safely, follow the lamp that's at your feet. If you follow in the leadership of the Spirit step by step in your life, guess where you're going to end up? You're going to end up in great places. But as soon as you stray, I want you to be aware of your emotions. You'll be frustrated. You'll be agitated. You'll be wondering why you're not getting the thanks. You'll be looking for your own title. It's okay. I'm not beating you up. Learn the lesson. Go back to leadership of the Spirit. That isn't working. It's not working. I got to go back and trust God. Why? Because trusting God is the only way I can walk through this mess of a world and have peace, love, patience, kindness, joy, gentleness, mercy, and be free. And the more you give, the more he provides. The more good news you share, the more good news he tells you. Now tell him this. Now give him that. Tell him how much I love him. Tell him I'm never going to leave them. Tell him I'll never leave them, nor will I forsake them. Tell him they're victorious. They don't have to worry about failure. Now it's starting to sound like good news, isn't it? Because that's what Jesus came to do. And the Pharisee says, if we tell them that, then they won't follow us. And Jesus said, that's right. And that's what's making you mad. You're not their God. Even if you think you are, you're not. So as we go forward here, maybe you're in a position, maybe you only, it's not about whether you come to church or not. Maybe you just come to church on Christmas and Easter. I don't care. I'm not taking attendance, and neither is God. But if you're seeking God on a daily basis, and maybe you find him when you're out in the fishing boat, or maybe you've just used that as an excuse. You know when I'm with God is when I'm fishing. Whatever. But if you don't get real with God, that's between you and him. If you don't know who your God is, then you and God got to figure something out. Jesus said to his disciples, who do those people say I am? Well, some people think you're John the Baptist. Some people think you're risen. Some people, oh, so they don't know who I am. Okay, but who do you say I am? Well, Lord, you're the Son of the risen God. Well, blessed are you, my friend, because the only way you'd know that is by the revelation of the Spirit. If you don't know who your God is, and maybe you answer the question like this, well, who's Jesus? What do you believe? If you start your answer like this, this is an alert for you. Well, we believe that You hear the problem? What do you believe? If you're going to a we believe mentality, then who's we? Are they right? Or are you being led by somebody who wants you to believe what we as a group believe? You better figure out what you believe. Get it? Good. I got it figured out. I don't have all the answers, but I know for me, I'm going to trust God, and he's going to lead me. And so far, for 20 years, it has gotten better and better and better, and I'm going, this is easy. I didn't even know that I changed so much. Thank you, Lord, for all you do in my life. So as we close up here, Kat and Doug, are they still here? Yes, they are. Kat and Doug do communion. And I'm still working on the shirt, but our new shirts are going to say, I love my hug from Kat and Doug. And if you haven't met Kat and Doug, the communion table is open to all. Okay, you don't have to be part of this denomination. You don't have to be part of this church. You don't have to jump through any hoops. Jesus said, as you do these things, do it in remembrance of me, what I have done. Don't try and figure out if you're worthy. I made you worthy. Come accept the gift of worthiness. Okay, the table is open to you. If you're a child of God, the table's open. Come dine at the table. While you're eating the bread, be reminded that Jesus' body was broken so that you could be forgiven. And that his blood was spilled out so that you could be washed clean. And you, read it in Romans 6, are dead to sin. And in Romans 7, you're dead to the law. And in Romans 8, you are alive in Christ. Hallelujah. Praise God for the spirit he put down to lead us and guide us. We have our contingent here from Michigan. And so here we got a Michigan, we got two M states. We're looking for some A states and some C states. This next song is, I'm doing this in honor of our friend Gene Lofton. He was Gene, the walking machine to so many in town. He was Uncle Gene to so many in town. I did his memorial this past week, and he was a, I would guess, physically and mentally challenged adult. Last Sunday would have been his 69th birthday. He was a dedicated man who walked the streets of this city for 15 years. He raised well over $150,000 for the Ark of St. Lucie by himself, dollar at a time. And his nephew summed it up best at his service the other day. His nephew got up and he said, "You know, I'm Uncle Gene's favorite nephew." He said, "But I have been to a lot of funerals, but for some reason it feels like Gene isn't gone. It feels like he's here right beside me, and I haven't been able to figure out why." And he said he thought about it for several days, and he said he finally came up with the answer. He said, "Uncle Gene is a legend. And legends don't die." So our local legend, Gene Lofton, this was played at his funeral service, and I hope we can do it justice, because Gene walked and walked and walked. I found him as far south as Jupiter, walking from Fort Pierce. I found him as far north as Sebastian and Wabasso, and pull over and say, "Gene, what are you doing here?" And in his best way that he could speak, "I'm collecting money. Do you want to ride home?" "No. I have more stops." At his services, I met people from businesses who knew nobody of the family, and they saw the services were going on, and he showed up, and they said, "I have a business up the street, and every week Gene has been coming to the door with his envelope, and every week everybody would give him a dollar or two, and he's done that for 3 weeks." He would ask people he cared about what their birthday was, and if it was 9 months away, he would show up on their birthday with a big sheet cake for them all over town, not just a few people. He did it here. He asked Mark every week, "Is this your birthday, Mark?" And Mark would go, "No, you're not bringing me a cake, Gene." He wouldn't tell Gene when his birthday was. If he knew your birthday, you were getting a sheet cake. It wasn't just a little two-man thing. It was, it's time for a birthday party. That was Gene. And that shows his heart of giving. So this is for Gene, and we're going to incorporate this more and more in our songs. But we've only had 1 week to practice it, but we're going to do our best. Oh, I got the wrong song. Sorry, I twisted them around and I didn't change them in my book.
When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of the storm is a walk on.
So Gene is walking eternally in heaven. That's what I know for sure.
Jesus,
if you can tell, but we like to have fun here.
Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Tell everyone you see, or tell for me, that Jesus is alive and well.
Coming of the Lord's nigh. You better get your house in order. He's gonna split the eastern sky. Get the message out to the people.
Let's tell it while it's time to tell. The Son of God is coming.
Hallelujah!
Jesus is alive and well. Our Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Tell everyone you see, he'll tell for me. Jesus is alive and well. He's seated with the Heavenly Father. He's interceding for you and me. And tell everyone you see, I'll tell them for me, that Jesus is alive and well.
When we nail my Jesus to that old cross, the devil danced around in glee. He thought he had the children of God, and he would take them, throw them in the fiery, fiery sea. But on the third day, the storm was rolling away. The angel said, Mary, go and tell that the Son of God is risen.
Hallelujah!
Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Tell everyone you see, or tell them for me. Jesus is alive and well. He's seated with the Heavenly Father. He's interceding for you and me. Jesus is alive and well. He's seated with the Heavenly Father. He's interceding for you and me. Tell everyone you see, I'm telling for me, that Jesus is alive and well. Jesus is alive and well. Let's
hear it for our drummer. God bless you. Have a great, great Easter. Remember, you don't have to tell everybody about Jesus. You get to. It's good news. Pass it on. God bless you.